A mother experiences her children dying essentially back to back. But what was the cause of their deaths? No one could figure this out. Was it SIDS, a death gene, or simply just bad luck? But most importantly, was this a story of a grieving mother or a sick, twisted psychopath desperate for attention? Let's get into the story of Mary Beth Tenning. Hi guys, my name is Jillian and welcome to Unwind and Mystery. Yeah, where you unwind and chill out with me as I talk about a true crime case. If you're new to my channel, welcome. I tell true crime stories while putting a face mask on my face. And if that's something you're interested in, you should definitely subscribe. And if you've been to my channel before and you haven't subscribed, what the heck are you doing? Subscribe. So guys, your girl's a little bit frustrated. This is my second time recording this case. My camera cut off and my memory card said, what memory? I'm all out of it. It was corrupted. So now this is my second time recording this. Hopefully my skin doesn't get upset with me for putting a mask on my face back to back. But the mask that I'm using today is going to be the Teamy Green Tea Blend Face Mask. Now let's get into the story. Mary Beth Rowe was born on September 11th of 1942 in upstate New York. Her childhood wasn't very stable. Her dad was off serving in World War II, and her mother was constantly working to try to support her family. So she was really never home either. And because of this, Mary Beth was shuffled around to various family members' homes to be taken care of. One of these family members told the poor child that her parents didn't want her. And Mary Beth believed this because where were her parents? Nowhere to be found. She really loved her dad, but he was extremely physically abusive to her, and he would often put her in a closet so he wouldn't have to hear her crying. Her school life wasn't that great either. She was a loner and not by choice. And she was seen as very attention seeking. Her pupils really didn't like her. They thought she was a liar who told tall tales. Her childhood reminds me very much of Miss Mary Bell. If you know, you know. She graduated high school in 1961 and she had dreams of going to college. But those dreams were only just dreams at the moment because her grades were too bad to be accepted into any college. So instead of climbing up the path towards college, she was now a working girl. She found odd-end jobs that didn't pay much, but eventually got a job at Ellis Hospital working as a nursing assistant. Mary Beth really wanted to date, and she was set up on a date with a guy she didn't know named Joseph Tenning. She liked Joseph. He was pretty chill and quiet, so the two started dating. 2 years later, they decided to tie the knot and the couple got married. Mary Beth gave birth to a daughter in May of 1967 and they named her Barbara. 2 years later, she gave birth to a son named Joseph Jr., aka Joey. The family seemed like your normal, happy, everyday family. The kids were happy and cared for, and Mary Beth finally accomplished the two main goals in her life, which was marriage and family. But she never lost the desire to be seen and heard and have all eyes on her. The girl was desperate for attention. Mary Beth got pregnant again, but unfortunately for her, dad had a heart attack in October of 1971 while he was at work. Mary Beth rushed to the hospital to be by his side. Even though he wasn't the greatest father to her, she really loved him. But her dad had absolutely no time for her. He was upset that he even had to waste his last dying breaths dealing with a child that he did not like. Like, I'm trying to die here in peace. Why are you here disturbing it? He was so annoyed and irritated by her presence that he even refused to tell her that he loved her before he died. Now, even though her dad was a dust bucket, Mary Beth so badly craved his love, care, and attention, so she was devastated when her father passed. And when this happened, something inside of her switched. Something rather dark. So Mary Beth had gotten pregnant again, and she claimed that she wanted her daughter Jennifer to be born in time for Christmas, so she tried to induce her labor herself. But when she delivered her baby, it was discovered that Jennifer actually had a meningitis infection and passed away after being in the hospital for 8 days. And when nurses told her this, she seemed kind of blah about it. Not mad, not sad, just blah. Of course, losing a baby is sad, and on the outside, Mary Beth seemed sad, but on the inside, she was a giddy weirdo. People surrounded her with love, giving her gifts and hugs, and Mary Beth got off on this. She was stoked, amped up, and ready to go. She finally got the attention that she so desperately wanted. They had a funeral for baby Jennifer, and she shed no tears and seemed to be pretty void of all emotions. But once the reception hit, she was having herself a grand old time. Shortly after Jennifer died, Mary Beth took her clothes and had herself a little laundry day. She washed them, ironed them, and folded them. Then she took her clothes, her toys, basically everything she brought for the baby, and tossed it away in the garbage. Her behaviors were strange to say the least, but she was a grieving mother, so no one really wanted to bother her or question her about this strange behavior. January 20th of 1972 was another tragic day for the Tenning family. Their son, Joey, was rushed to the hospital because Mary Beth said that he was having a seizure. He was examined and it was proven that he was fine and he was suffering from nothing. Just in case they missed anything, they kept him in the hospital for a little over a week just to be sure, and they also gave him medicine for an infection. Then they let him go, he was fine, and they were sure everything would be okay. But just when the doctors and nurses were probably moving on to new patients or taking their lunch break, Mary Beth busts through the hospital doors again, this time saying that Joey had died. She says she put him down for a nap, and then when she went in his room to check on him, he wasn't breathing and he was blue. They determined that his COD was cardiopulmonary arrest, but no autopsy was done. Mary Beth's friends and family rushed to her side and showered her with the two things she loved the most, love and affection. Once all the love and attention was gone, she had herself a little laundry day with Joey's clothes and got rid of them and the rest of his stuff. My question is, where is the husband after all of this, just allowing his wife to get rid of their baby stuff? Where was he? A month and a half later, Mary Beth shows up to the ER with 4-year-old Barbara. She said that she was having a seizure. But at this point, the hospital had their spidey senses up and ready when Mary Beth came in. They had her rap sheet on standby just in case she ever came in again. And this time when she came in, they wanted to put her under observation. Mary Beth said absolutely not and took Barbara and her butt back home. Again, the hospital was probably just getting over Mary Beth's hysterics when Mary Beth comes back to the hospital, now saying that Barbara was unconscious. They tried so hard to bring Barbara back to life, but unfortunately, she slipped into a coma and passed away. Her COD was determined to be Reye's syndrome, which is a swelling of the liver and brain, but no autopsy was performed. Which was strange because they were already suspicious of Mary Beth, so why wouldn't they want to be sure that the baby actually passed away from that? So now rumors are swirling about the family. How weird was it that 3 kids from the same family, 3 seemingly normal healthy kids, died basically back to back to back? It didn't make any sense. So of course it had to be a death gene that caused their untimely passing. There was nothing else. First of all, what is a death gene? I mean, the conclusions people came up with before the internet were crazy. Didn't they used to think because women had periods they were witches? I feel like that's true, but I don't know if I made that up. People went from saying, oh, poor Mary Beth, poor mother, to saying, what kind of mother was Mary Beth really? One of the neighbors actually remembered the day that Mary Beth took Barbara to the hospital because Barbara was actually at her house that day. She was having fun, and when Mary Beth said that it was time for her to go home, she was whining. Of course, she didn't want to leave. She was having fun. When she wouldn't leave peacefully, Mary Beth told her that if she wouldn't stop, that she would end up with her brother. The neighbors should have been questioning that then and there. There was also a nurse where Mary Beth worked who thought she was pretty sketch. But when she told the doctor about this, the doctor basically just brushed her off. Mary Beth was not really feeling the lack of attention she received from her last child passing away. And she didn't really like the strange looks and the whispers about her. So she told her husband, let's kick rocks and let's move. And they moved to a neighborhood not too far from where they lived. Like, what was the point of that? If you really wanted to leave, you should have hopped states, countries, continents. Also, why is her husband so chill about everything? I mean, that was something that she liked about him when they started dating, but he's too chill. Mary Beth quit her job as a nurse and became a waitress. In 1973, Mary Beth became pregnant again, and her coworkers were very sympathetic towards her. They knew she was a grieving mother who got rid of all her late kids' stuff because it was just too hard to be around. So they threw her a baby shower. Their fourth child, Timothy, was born on Thanksgiving. He was a teeny thing weighing 5 pounds, but despite this, he was healthy. But Timothy, who was a healthy 3-week-old baby, was brought to the hospital by his mother, who said that she found him in his crib, not moving. The doctors were puzzled because they couldn't find anything wrong with Timothy, so they chalked it up to SIDS, which is sudden infant death syndrome, which happens when a seemingly normal baby dies in their crib and there is no concrete cause of death. The nonchalant husband, Joseph, or Joe as he was called, told his brother that his food had started tasting a little weird. His brother, who already thought Mary Beth was not too right in the head, told Joe to go to the doctors, get himself checked out, basically make sure that he wasn't being poisoned. But it's Joe we're talking about. Slow Joe. He said, nah, man, I'm okay. I don't need to go to the hospital. This was honestly his whole mantra in life. I'm okay. Everything is okay. We are all okay. Joe honestly never really seemed bothered about anything. His children's deaths, the possibility of him being poisoned. He also was very withdrawn at all of his children's funerals and wore the exact same suit at every one. And if I'm telling the truth, he really gets on my nerves. But his brother had every right to be worried, especially when Mary Beth called him, telling him that Joe was dead. Him and his wife immediately went over to the couple's house. And interestingly enough, Mary Beth had not called the ambulance, the police, nothing. She had her clothes on and was crying with her theatrics and saying that she had nothing to do with his death. Joe actually didn't die. When he got to the hospital, a crap ton of barbiturates was found in his system. Even a teeny tiny bit more in his system would have killed him. He was obviously drugged, but sleepy slow Joe chose not to press charges on Mary Beth. And guess what happened after? Mary Beth got pregnant again. She told her coworkers, and they were all genuinely shocked. Why would you have yet another child? But Mary Beth said, I'm a woman. That's what we do. Like, ew, confident for what? But they were like, well, I hope this baby doesn't have the death gene. And they threw her another baby shower. Nathan was born on Easter Sunday of 1975. The hospital knew of the family's history, so they gave him an apnea monitor. But 5 months later, Mary Beth showed up to work, holding a lifeless Nathan in her arms, saying that they were driving and he just stopped breathing. Her coworkers are like, why would you come here? Go to the hospital. Even though the hospital where she worked was basically right there, she chose not to take him there. She chose to skip that hospital, go to another one, and when she arrived, Nathan had already passed away. He was a healthy baby, and his cause of death was SIDS yet again, and there was no autopsy performed yet again. Now, people were over Mary Beth at this point, just like me and just like you. No more sympathy was thrown her way. People were upset. At their funerals, she would show up happy like she was the main character. Also, every time her children died, she would get their insurance money and go on shopping sprees. And she was even heard saying that the check for Nathan was going towards new drapes and wallpaper. And what I'm about to tell you is not a joke. It's not a bad punchline. It's the truth. Mary Beth and Joe put in an application to be adoptive parents. The caseworkers knew of the family's history, but they felt bad for the couple, and they gave them a foster child. He was with them for a short time, but then left, and then they got a 10-year-old foster daughter. Sleepy Joe actually showed some emotion for the girl. They had a tight bond, but when Mary Beth got pregnant again, she kicked the girl out of their house. They officially adopted a newborn baby named Michael in August of 1978. And 2 months later, she gave birth to a daughter named Mary Frances. And when she was born, Michael was honestly an afterthought. But yet again, Mary Beth found herself at the hospital with Mary Frances saying that she had a seizure. She brought her in just in time, and Mary Frances was able to go home alive. But a month later, she brought her back saying that she was having a heart attack. They were able to revive her again, but she had to be put on life support because of the severe brain damage she received from this. Sadly, she passed away not too long after this. It seemed like Mary Beth's life was on repeat. Have a baby. Baby gets sick. Baby passes away. Mary Beth gets rid of all their clothes, toys, and all the rest of their stuff. Has a funeral, cashes the insurance money, and then gets pregnant again. John was born in the fall of 1979, and shortly after he was born, he was brought to the hospital unconscious. Doctors were able to revive him and sent him to Boston Hospital to have some tests done. He was perfectly fine and healthy, so they sent him home. But not too long after, they returned to the hospital because Jonathan was now brain dead. And he passed away on March 24th of 1980. Now at this point, if you weren't a Mary Beth skeptic, you were now. People were extremely suspicious of Mary Beth. Everyone except the doctors and her husband, Sleepy Joe. I really hate him. I don't know who annoys me more, him or her. It's like flipping two sides of a dirty, dusty, delusional, psychotic coin. Doctors really believed that these kids had a genetic disorder. In March of 1981, Mary Beth went to go wake up their adoptive son, Michael. But when she went to wake him up, he was unresponsive, so she brought him to the hospital. Again, skipping past the hospital she used to work at, which was basically right next to her house. She took him to another hospital that was not yet open, so she waited for them to open, and by the time they opened, Michael was already dead. So now this death gene theory is in the garbage. Because Michael was not related to them. He was not biologically their son. So now everyone, including the doctors, are voicing their outrage and saying how suspicious this is, but all their concerns were brushed away. Mary Beth got pregnant again. This beach is fertile. Tammy Lynn was born in August of 1985. Again, a happy, healthy, normal baby. But 4 months later, in December, Mary Beth called her neighbor, Cynthia Walker, hysterical, saying that something happened to Tammy Lynn. Of course, Cynthia comes over immediately, seeing Tammy Lynn on her changing table, purple and unconscious. Cynthia realizes Mary Beth never called the hospital, the ambulance, so she yells at her to call them. The baby had passed away by the time she arrived at the hospital, and Mary Beth said this was because she had a blanket wrapped around her head, and that is why she passed away. At this point, the doctors are already onto her. This is her 10th healthy child that had now died under BS circumstances, and all the fingers are pointing to Mary Beth. Cynthia went to the couple's house the next day to just check on them, see how they were doing, and she saw them eating breakfast nonchalantly without a care in the world. Shortly after Tammy Lynn's funeral, Mary Beth had a brunch, and even her sister noticed how calm and happy Mary Beth was. Like it was just a normal day. They actually did an autopsy, surprise, surprise, but nothing came out of it, so her cause of death was determined to be SIDS. But this was not enough for the chief of police. He wasn't gonna settle for this answer. And he asked a forensic pathologist if it was possible that 9 healthy children from one family could all die from SIDS. And the forensic pathologist said, "H-E double hockey sticks, no." He said, and I quote, One sudden infant death is a tragedy. Two is suspicious. And three is murder until proven otherwise. Well, this woman had nine, so we're going with murder. He looked into the children's medical files, and he said that there was no such thing as a death gene, and this doesn't even make sense because Michael was not their blood relative. He also says when a baby dies from SIDS, they don't turn blue, and the children were almost all blue when they passed away. He also thought it was weird that Mary Beth claims that some of the kids had seizures, but she was the only one who saw this, and she was also the only one with them when they passed away. He said that they were probably killed by homicidal asphyxiation. Finally, someone in the story with some sense. They questioned her on February 4th of 1986. And at first she told police she had nothing to do with nothing, but then she confessed and said she killed Timothy, Nathan, and Tammy Lynn. She said she suffocated them with pillows, and she did this because she was not a good mother. How can you be a good mother if you're the devil's spawn? Of course you're not. Her annoying, sleepy husband Joe came to visit her, and she told him that she killed Tammy Lynn. A 36-page confession was typed up explaining how she killed her three children, but she said that she was absolutely innocent of any wrongdoing or murder for the other seven kids. She was charged and arrested for the murder of Tammy Lynn. They tried to exhume the three bodies, but two of them were too badly decomposed. This case was a big deal when it got out. People were pissed at the neighbors, families, friends, social workers, but especially the doctors. Like, how could all these poor babies die and no one do nothing about it? The biggest damage done was since all of their deaths basically were written off as natural causes, no autopsies were done except for in the case of Tammy Lynn. So no autopsies equals no investigations, which led to more of the children dying. Her trial began on June 22nd of 1987, and she was only charged in the murder of Tammy Lynn because there was no evidence for any of the other kids. I guess circumstantial evidence wasn't a thing for this case. Mary Beth never took the stand. After 29 hours, the jury said that she was guilty of second-degree murder, and she was sentenced to Bedford Hills Prison for Women. In 1989, she was tried for the deaths of Nathan and Timothy, but because there was no evidence, the charges were dropped. The forensic pathologist said he believed that she had Munchausen by proxy syndrome, which is a mental disorder where a parent or guardian makes up an illness or injury for the child or the person that they're caring for, where they will lie about their symptoms, tamper with their test, to make their child or the person under their care seem sick. And this often causes serious harm or death to the child or the person on the end of this nonsense. Now, her case is strange because usually people who do this make this a drawn-out, elaborate scheme, but it seemed like Mary Beth didn't have the time, effort, or simply intelligence, in my opinion, to do this. I don't think she ever had the desire to become a mother. She just wanted the sympathy that came along with her children dying. She's a sick, deranged, and evil woman. And now, if you guys think Dee Dee Blanchard was bad, Gypsy Rose's mom, Dee Dee had nothing on Mary Beth Tenning. On August of 2018, she was released on parole and is now living with her sleepy husband Joe and laying low. I hate her. But that is the story of psychotic, deranged Mary Beth Tenning. How is she out of jail? The world may never know. But that's it for this case. I hope you guys enjoyed hearing me talk about this crazy, sad, demented story. If you guys did, please make sure to give this video a like, throw me a little comment, subscribe if you must, and I will see you guys in my next video. Toodles!